Hi, I'm Amanda Brookman, Climate and Ecological Emergency Lead with Volunteer Cornwall. Thanks for watching this brief film. So, the climate and ecological crises are getting louder and louder, and we know that those in our communities here in Cornwall, here and afar, who are in any way vulnerable are hit first and worst by these crises, and that includes human life and other life. And as we're all clocking, we're a bit dependent on all those other forms of life on the planet, and we do actually care about what happens to us all. So we in the community and voluntary sector are working hard to support those communities of human and non-human life. The thing is, we can be having a negative impact on the climate and biodiversity, and of course, their breakdown is having an impact on us. So as leaders of change, we need to step up, right? So we decided to talk to some of the voluntary and community sector leaders in Cornwall to see what we think, what we feel, and what action we're starting to take. Have a listen. It's good stuff.
My name is Kenny Raybould and I work for Battling On, which is part of Together We Can Succeed, based in East Cornwall.
So I'm Callum Devaney, I'm Head of Nature Reserves at Cornwall Wildlife Trust.
And I'm Carolyn Cadman, I'm Chief Exec of Cornwall Wildlife Trust.
Okay, I'm Tim Jones and I'm Chief Exec of Community Energy Plus.
So I'm Sarah Marsh. I work for a charity called Suburban Community Trust.
I'm angry. I find that this is something, as my professional background has always been within horticulture. I have, and I think anyone that works with plants or with animals has a natural instinct and understanding of how, when the very slightest shift in our climate happens, how that affects the whole chain. And it's something that we are seeing more and more and more of.
For me personally, the climate and ecological emergency, it does make me apprehensive. So that kind of sense of not being able to control what's happening. So that's a sense of dread. But to try and sort of rationalise that within myself, or to try and overcome that, have to have some optimism that we can do something about it.
The climate and ecological crisis makes me feel really anxious and concerned about the future. I worry about extinctions happening that we know from our State of Nature Cornwall report are likely to happen, not just driven by climate change, but intensive agriculture, fishing, development, how we manage water. These things are all impacting at the same time, so that makes me concerned and anxious about the future.
Very, very worried in terms of our planet and how it's going to impact on the whole of the planet, but also very worried about how it's going to impact in terms of equity.
I'm optimistically pessimistic about the impacts that we can have.
I always answer this question in terms of, I have 9 grandchildren, and their future makes me feel very worried. And I do what I do because I want to be able to look them in the eye and say, I've done something to improve their future, if I can.
We have taken a look at this and gone, this is by far one of the biggest threats to us as an organisation. And we recognise that as the future evolves, that the climate and ecological crisis will also affect everything from being able to gain grants, being able to, the increase of needs of our users will only increase, the access to good food, good housing will be diminished because the resources by central governments and sort of local governments will be directed in other avenues. So off of the back of our climate emergency and ecological declaration, we are launching a project called Grown That Way. And Grown That Way is about celebrating the individual and the environment we live in, and that it is built that way. This is how it works. This is this understanding, you know, that sort of neurodiversity. It has to be embedded in everything we do. Grown That Way fundamentally will be a project that enables users to learn and skills train in new areas of horticulture, be it technology or traditional methods, but it also is a wraparound to the rest of the organisations as a way to embed sustainability practices across the business over the next 10 years?
I would say not enough. We do things like our allotments and growing and getting people connected to soil. We've just done a Save Our Soil March for the Worms from Heartlands to Pengegan allotments with families who made a wriggly worm. It was really about raising awareness, and we're working with Cornwall Craft, the Vista CIC, to raise both the scientific awareness of climate change and the importance of worms.
So one of the things we've just recently done is we've started trialling electric chainsaws. That is proving to be, they're working out well. So we're looking at how we can increase those sorts of changes, where we've just switched this year from total reliance on a diesel generator, and we now have solar and wind. So the properties on that island, on that marine nature reserve, are now all running from renewable energy.
As an organisation, we have invested in a carbon reduction officer, and she has helped us to understand our carbon footprint. A lot of our carbon goes on our commuting to this office, to home. So we've had a grant from the local parish council to install electric vehicle charging points, which are working well. And we're also trialling electric bikes. So we had a staff day in a couple of weeks ago, or a couple of months ago now, and we all got a chance to whiz around site on an electric bike. And we're talking to the transport providers about whether there's a cycling hub that can go from our office down to train stations and public transport as well.
We've just bought an electric minibus. We're in the process of buying an electric minibus specifically for a project, but that will get more and more use. I picked up two people from the train station this morning on my way through. Right through the staff, we're all sort of really going for it and trying to do more and more of what we can do individually to help the situation.
So within Trevor Urban Community Trust, we're making some progress within the team, I guess. Probably 2 years ago, as an organisation, we declared a climate emergency, switching to a green energy provider, looking at what we could do as individuals to reduce our transport and how we can support each other to enable that to happen. COVID, for all its horrendousness, actually forced us to work from home a lot more, and that's fundamentally changed the way that our transport works as an organisation. And then there's kind of the influence that we have as an organisation within the wider community and the projects that we run that can actually enable people to be part of the solution to take climate action themselves.
Well, we've had a bit of a breakthrough this year. For a long time, I've struggled to find funding for advisors who can specifically bring experience of renewables to educate people, and this year for the first time we've had specific funding. So I've got 1.5 advisors with time and the skills and ability to talk to people and educate, because I think one of the big things that we recognise is, whilst we will quite happily talk about solar PV on roofs or heat pumps, there's a big gap in public understanding of those technologies.
The next steps is about, I think, is partnering more with people and sharing. What we recognise is that we need to share more, but yes, money is a big problem for everyone. And I think to be able to share greater amongst us, not just with our resources, but being able to include each other in bids would be a really powerful way of literally us in Cornwall and the Southwest just taking over. And, you know, going, look, this is how we're doing it. You lot need to stand up. And that's where we're going. Like, if I use, for example, where we're launching this project, looking at the food side of things that we're growing and how, you know, and we're embedding that. We've got everything through from yourselves, Volunteer Cornwall, that have pushed us on this great sort of climate side, to the University of Plymouth helping us with our food research and our technology, to the likes of Tamar Grow Local, supporting us as well, and China Fleet buying our produce. And what we're trying to show is this connection of different businesses from first, second, third sector, where nice people are involved, great things happen. And that's where we want to go. And basically we just want to be that part of that powerhouse. We are not precious. We are together, we're a powerhouse, and we're going to take this on. That's what we want to happen next. But it's got to start somewhere.
I'd love to see more advances in technology so that we can reduce our own carbon footprint. So yeah, we do use heavy equipment and machinery on nature reserves, but more and more of it is becoming electric. So those advances are going to be fantastic, and we will keep a pace with those. Would love, you know, I do enjoy Cornwall Wildlife Trust having more land, but we can't manage, you know, we can't take on too much. We've got limited resources. So we want to make sure that the land we have is inspiring others. So we want to see more action taken on other people's land. I suppose a big dream for us, I think we are looking at some of our reserves becoming a bit wilder. We would love to buy some land where we can perhaps help to facilitate big herbivores, more natural grazing systems happen. We've done some work with beavers, but we'd like to see that happen in a bigger landscape. So if we could, that would be a dream, if that could happen from one of our reserves, have a much wilder landscape with natural grazing. That would be fantastic.
And I guess what I would love is more people related. So I would really love for the resident population of Cornwall and for our visitors to notice nature more, to understand the seasons, to understand what happens. Maybe for everyone to have five key facts about nature in Cornwall that mean something to them. You know, whether it's Cornish choughs, their story of coming back, or Cornish hedges, the habitat and the services that hedges do for Cornwall. I'd love some kind of increased baseline in understanding and connection with nature.
What I think needs to be done is we need to properly insulate homes in Cornwall, and particularly get to grips with all our solid wall homes. We've been talking about it for years, but that's to me the number one priority, and it's in the sense it's nothing particularly innovative or groundbreaking, other than we need to do it at scale, and we've never been able to find the mechanisms to properly get homes to the standard that people can comfortably be warm and not be worried about both the carbon that they're emitting and the cost of the energy that they're using.
So I'd love to see a community transport scheme, possibly electric cars, electric bikes, something that we can coordinate and resource through the local community, and again, making that really affordable as well. We would love to see more people growing their own food. There's so many benefits to it. Largely, we're a rural community. Most people have got access to some kind of green space, or we've got shared public spaces that people could be growing in. And I think with food prices rising, that there will be, in the foreseeable future, a need for people to be more resilient. And the other thing that we're witnessing is the real impact of poor housing. So I'd love to see some different housing ownership models, more community-owned housing, run by communities, owned by communities, and managed and maintained by communities as well. I'd love to see more, less people thinking the council, the government need to be doing this and this, but and communities being better empowered to come up with their own solutions, and that needs resourcing. And that's kind of my aspirations really for the next 5 or 10 years, to see some of that stuff come to fruition.
What inspires me to keep going, and I suppose inspires me to do what I do? I think all of us, you know, working throughout this sector, but also personally as well, working with plants have always been my inspiration. That is my personal note. And seeing that direct link change has inspired me to get angry about what we're seeing. And also, I think when you going back to one of the other questions, when we come together and we talk, it's other people just talking and going, you know, well, this and this, you know, and this is happening, or have you seen this? Have you read that? Because we are sharing, and sharing really inspires me. And this is all part of that system of how we step forward with a better quality of life in a future where the planet's going, hang on a minute, I'm a little bit annoyed, you know.
I love activism. I love the power of singing. I love the power that that brings us together in a different way, and how that can bring a different way to protest. And finding our ways and new ways, rather than that we're going to storm your barricades. I was so impressed by some of the stuff that happened around G7. I thought it was highly creative, and that makes a mark.
Inspiration comes from lots of different places, lots of different people. And from results, from seeing the impacts of what we're doing already, that inspires me. The volunteers that pitched up this morning when it was raining to tidy up the community garden and clean the war memorial, they inspire me. You know, it's lots of small pieces of hope. It could be a drawing that my daughter's done. It could, you know, that inspiration comes from lots of different places. Hearing from other people about the challenges they're facing and how they're overcoming them, that's inspiring.
Quite a long time ago, I used to be a trustee for Citizens Advice, and I love going to the meetings because I came away angry because they did the sort of social justice perspective of clients that they were dealing with. And still, for me, I suppose what gets me out of the bed each day to do this is the people we meet. So it's the normal, everyday Cornish home householders, all with different challenges, all with contributions to make, but many of them struggling. That's really what still fires me up. And it, part of it is around a motivation that you know, we are facing serious injustice and we need to see things changed, and people are being discriminated against, and you know, the evil that is poverty that traps people, you know, we see every day. And that to me is the bit that motivates me.
I think with in terms of working with more people to have more impact from our nature reserves and the land we own, the thing is to look to our neighbours and other landowners in Cornwall, because we can't just manage sites in isolation. They're part of bigger natural systems. So we do want to work with more landowners, more farmers, through the advice work that we do through farm advisors. And if those landowners can be doing particular bits of habitat management or creation on their land that links with our land, it's gonna obviously create a much bigger nature recovery network in the county that will benefit both wildlife, and then have that impact in terms of habitats, which are going to help with the climate emergency as well.
Yeah, in terms of people, I'd like the Trust to be working with more people who think they don't like nature, who think it's boring, who don't want to get their hands and feet wet or muddy. I'd like to work with more of those people, or maybe they're volunteering, maybe they're coming out on a walk or talk, because they're the ones who we can quite easily help to have a revelation about how nature and climate change are under threat and how it's really important to do something about it.
I suppose one of the bits that I'm looking for is people who are good communicators, because for me, you know, a lot of the stuff around the climate challenges that we're facing, there's a whole load of education that we need, and we're already seeing people sort of shooting off at different directions with what they feel is the best approach. Planting lots of trees, okay, yes, that makes sense in terms of the ecological emergency, but it doesn't address the carbon challenge, and we need to be working with people who understand that bigger picture about how do we cope with the disruption that significant decarbonisation will bring. And so I'm looking for educators who will and communicators who can sort of package what I do up in a more accessible way. And, you know, for me, that's about, you know, me engaging with, you know, people who are good at putting it in everyday language and finding the right hooks, you know, that will attract people in to say, okay, well, this is something I can do.
I'd love to work more with young people, and I'd love to work with some of our community elders, because I think that combination could be really exciting. I think some of the young people we work with have got some fabulous ideas, and I think some of the community elders are natural recyclers and environmentalists. My grandmother never threw away an elastic band. She used to have an enormous ball of them, and she, all the cellophane that card came in, she would keep and recycle it and do different things with it, put different things into it. You know, that pieces of newspaper and old brown paper and bits of string, all those kind of natural things, because they were used to hardship and not having an infinite of supply. I'm a director of a scrap store, and whenever I go up to see Ben, I'm amazed by the amount of stuff that's thrown away.
Locally, I'd like to be working with every single resident within the community that we serve. I'd like to see everyone engaged in some way in taking climate action at whatever level they can, in whatever way they can, to the very best of their ability. On a kind of more strategic level, I'd love to see more cross-sector working. So the conference I was on yesterday was for the clinicians, who are doing amazing work. But and then there's another thing in a couple of weeks' time, which is about communities. And there's, you know, I'd like to see more cross section. That, you know, there's stuff happening in the education sector as well. And that I know that if we look at the whole, it's too big to tackle. But if we look at things in silo, then we simplify too much. And everything is so complex and interlinked that we do need to be joining up those dots across everything. I don't know how you do that. All I know, I'm talking to lots of different people in lots of different ways, and that's how I can do it.
I would say simply, I guess, nature needs you. So we know that businesses are jumping, to some extent, I'm sad to say, on the bandwagon of climate change and nature recovery work, and claiming all sorts of successes to their customers as a way of showing that they're doing something about nature recovery and climate change, and many of them are doing good things. We know that the public sector is doing, has a lot of good headlines in terms of policy objectives in relation to climate change and the nature crisis, but the voluntary community sector has a level of integrity above those other two sectors. In theory, we should, according to the Charity Commission, and it's taking that integrity into the environmental space alongside the social space and, of course, the economic space, which is also important, and really prioritising environmental, that I think can set the voluntary sector apart from the others.
I think it is about, we are very good, I think, at talking to each other, and we need to find and improve those channels of communicating with each other. Some of the willingness and the energy that we've seen over the pandemic response, I'd like to see replicated in terms of the challenges we're facing for the, you know, addressing the climate catastrophe and the ecological catastrophe. So a key part of that is we need to be talking to each other about how do we engage the volunteers, and almost, you know, I'd love to be in a position where the public sector is playing catch up. We should be saying this is what is needed, this is how it's going to happen, these are the volunteers. Okay, public sector, if you want to help, put some money into it, but don't get in the way. We're not asking your permission. If you want to give us your endorsement, fine, but let's see the volunteering community sector take the lead.
So if I could say one thing to the volunteering community sector, it would be, get off your bloody arse and do stuff if you're not doing it. Use everything in your power. Make, you know, every contact that you have count. So there's make every contact count is training around health and making every conversation that you have with someone about health. We need to make every contact count about climate action. That every conversation we have.
I always strongly believe it. If you're in a meeting room with people discussing this and everyone feels uncomfortable and is getting quite heated about the subject, then you're onto a winner, because you're not maintaining the status quo of going, oh yeah, I'm happy to do that, because yes, we're all happy to sit at home and eat chocolate oranges and watch TV and keep our gas boilers burning. That's what we're used to. And that's not to say that we can't continue to eat chocolate oranges and have our heating on, but it's to say we need to do it in a different way. And the future, I think we're all, the future can be bleak if we choose to ignore what's going on. The future can be really bright. It's not saying we can't do this, we can't do that, we can't travel, we can't do this, we can't do that. That's not how it is. But we've just got to change this consumption. You know, we can live a vibrant life of great food and great travel and great living without all this other stuff that we don't need. We have this belief that we have a God-given right to everything. And we can do what we want. Well, Mother Nature is not going to do that, because she literally has been past her beer and she is going to throw it right back at us.